Now, attorney, are you seeing any connection with the death of Governor Degamo and the timing of the PNP filing the criminal complaints, these murder complaints against Congressman Tevez, which were actually from 2019?
Actually, from what I understand, because we have not yet been officially informed of the charges with respect to the alleged 2019 killings, it was a private person who filed the same, assisted by their own private lawyer. The timing there is suspect, because if the same happened in 2019, why file only now? It would appear that the filing thereof was merely riding on the publicity, the public sentiment, and the sympathy generated by the horrendous killing of Governor Degamo. With respect to the others, well, as we predicted, as Congressman Tevez predicted in December 28, 2022, in his Facebook page, and as we stated in our press conference in January 11, 2023, we would be raided, evidence would be planted, and there, as you have seen, Ma'am Karen, it has already happened. That is why we have no reason to doubt the accuracy of the reports reaching us with respect to threats to his life.
So who do you believe, who does he believe is behind the alleged planted evidence or actually the filing of this case in 2023? The resurfacing of a 2019 issue. Who does he believe is behind it?
Well, we have our information, we have our theories, but we believe now is not the time to divulge them. We want the authorities to do their own investigation, and we are appealing also to the authorities to do a proper and thorough investigation. Because what is usually done according to police procedurals is that there is a crime, there is an investigation, and suspects identified. Here, the obverse was true. There was a crime, suspects were identified, and then there was an investigation which gives rise to the suspicion and the apprehension that evidence would be tailor-made to fit the theory as to who the suspect is. So that is our apprehension here. There seems to be more to this than meets the eye, Ma'am Karen, and I'm sure that we are not the only ones who have perceived that this is more complicated. This is a very deep plot with respect to certain matters involving a turf war, a business, etc.
Okay, because the victims in the 2019 and 2023 killings are quite clear. In 2019, it's former Councillor Miguel Lopez Dumog. In 2023, it's Governor Degamo and eight others. Are you considering Arnulfo Tevez a victim as well?
Definitely, because, the entire machinery of government arrayed against him. This did not happen when, under the Duterte administration, Governor Degamo was investigated for the death of a journalist, Joel Pepino. It was an investigation that went through the usual course. Here, it would appear that a lot of legal shortcuts are being made. That is why we are really apprehensive. There are so many things, Ma'am Karen, that I regret I cannot divulge due to lawyer-client confidentiality and other promises. Other pledges of confidentiality and gentlemen's agreement between so many parties. But if these are revealed in due time, if there will come a time that they have to be revealed for the sake of truth and justice, then we will reconsider that.
But then how do you explain that when it comes to the 2019 death of the former counselor, no less than the affidavit of the gunman is the basis tagging Arnulfo Tevez as the mastermind and a few others?
There is a doctrine, Ma'am Karen, in law, which says that the confession only binds the confessor. And there is a doctrine called res inter alios acta, which means the act of a third person cannot bind anyone. Because it would be, the law and the courts recognize that it would be the easiest thing. Like, for instance, if I kill someone, and I am caught, I can simply say, no, Mr. X hired me, he paid me, I should be put under witness protection, I should be given immunity, and I will point to this person. That would be the easiest thing to exonerate myself. That is why the court said, if you confess to killing someone, that confession that you killed someone binds you. But if you point to someone that is still subject to other evidence, and your word will not be taken at face value. So it's not really as simple as that. It might make for good optics. It might make for good PR when you're trying to destroy someone. But in the end, when it comes to the courts, which are the ultimate arbiter of who are guilty and innocent, those things will not stand.
Okay, so moving to Degamo, they are known to be political rivals, but in his Facebook post, he mentioned specifically na ginamit siya sa politika, sa negosyo. Anong ibig sabihin po noon? Is there a business rival in this scenario?
There would appear to be certain undertones with respect to business, especially
kasi that sinabi pa niya, ginamit ang pera ko. Or ginamit ako sa pera, am I right?
Something to that effect. But as I've said, there are really serious currents, undercurrents and undertones here with respect to business, especially Isabong, which as everyone very well knows, nets billions a month in revenue. So as I've said, there is more to this than meets the eye. And at the proper time, all of these matters, if necessary, will be divulged.
Okay. And I'm curious, let's be honest here, did Congressman Tevez at any point have an Isabong, let's say, distributorship? Was he running Isabong in the province?
He had an application for Isabong, but now he's out of it because the president had prohibited the same. But as he was explaining, you really cannot stamp out Isabong because in this day and digital age, you don't even need to have the actual cockfight in the Philippines. You can have it anywhere in the world. You can bet through app. The bet-taking and the odds-making are fully digital. You do not even interact with a real person. And then money is to be made. That is why he went out of it when it was no longer allowed by law. And that is why he is bewildered as to why he kept being pointed to as one of the Isabong proponents when he had already been out of it.
So Congressman Tevez is not involved in Isabong or any form of gambling in any way?
Not anymore. There was a time when Isabong was allowed, when it was disallowed, then he went out of it, of course, as well as the other operators. He was not the only operator when it was being allowed.
Okay. So is he being framed by somebody who is involved in gambling?
We do not know who is framing him at this point. I would not want to indulge in conjectures and surmises, but definitely someone is framing him up. May nagkukumpas po rito, to state in the vernacular.
Now, his behavior doesn't inspire confidence, right? As a lawmaker, we expect lawmakers not to be possible lawbreakers, but to lead the way in actually submitting themselves to authorities. In the past, we've seen it, Attorney Topacio. We've had politicians who've actually evaded the law, right? Ano ang plano ni Congressman Tevez? Uuwi ba siya ng Pilipinas? Ano ba ang condition niya para umuwi?
I want to disabuse the minds of everyone that he's a lawbreaker. I mean, I challenge anyone at this point to state what law he has broken. His non-appearance before the House of Congress, those are purely administrative matters, and that is why the sanctions are administrative. Those are internal rules of the House. Those are not the acts of Congress. The person who breaks the law breaks or violates any of the positive acts enacted either by Congress or by the president or any agency or body with lawmaking authority. He has not done so. He has not been charged of any crime. He's not a fugitive from justice. And most importantly, his actions today are dictated by the principle of self-preservation, of self-defense, which, according to the law, trumps every other consideration.
On that note, Attorney Ferdinand Topacio, thank you for joining me today, and I do hope you update us soon. Thank you, sir.
Okay, thank you so much. Thank you for the opportunity, and my best regards to David. Thank you.
All right, thank you, sir. Thank you, Attorney.